Hello, hola and buenos dias. I'm Thomas, the editor of eustartups.com. Today for an exclusive interview with our partner ITNIC at the Makers of Barcelona. And with me today is Laura Fernandez from FutureFunded. And we're going to talk about women in tech today, about the new platform FutureFunded and how it might influence the current situation for women in tech in a positive way. So, Laura, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Let's maybe just start off. What is FutureFunded and what's the current state of the project?
Whoa. So, well, FutureFunded is the first and only crowdfunding platform to train the next generation of women in tech. Mm-hmm. So we start this in January this year, but that goes beyond that time, but we started this year in January. We've been developing, you know, our first platform. We have even pivoted since January until today, mm-hmm. And I have the pleasure to announce that today we are launching the first campaign, mm-hmm. crowdfunding campaign to fund Tatiana. She wants to become a junior developer, and she's reaching her goal like in the next 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. Quite optimistic.
Yeah. No. Okay. We will.
Nice. Okay. And do you think that the lack of funding was something before that was a problem for women who wanted to enter into the tech space? Is this a common problem?
I think we think money can be a barrier, but it's not the main barrier. So I think we don't have as many women in tech as we would like to have. Not because of the money, but because of the culture and the education system we are part of, you know, the society we live in. So when we were kids and we were, you know, at a school, you know, boys are taught that they should learn technology and machines and robots, and we are taught that we should learn, you know, other kind of stuff because we are more sensible and human, and we need to learn these kind of things. Mm-hmm. And those things are for us, and tech and computers and all that is the fun part, but this part is for them, mm-hmm. not for you, right? And so I think the problem starts the very, very beginning, and then we keep studying and learning and growing, and you find this moment where you have to choose your degree, you have to go to university, and then you look at the classes and you see that there are, if you go to engineer or mathematics, maybe you're going to be the only girl there. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you don't want to be the only girl. You want to have, I mean, you want to be surrounded by boys, but also by girls. You want to have peers that you understand, that you connect, that you have, you know, the same motivations, the same aspirations, of the same problem, that you feel you have an ecosystem, an environment that is comfortable for you. Mm-hmm. So a lot of girls, they decide to go to other sites because, I mean, they're not going to find their peers there. Mm-hmm. So I think there are all this like education and socialization that we carry during all these years. Mm-hmm. And then also, I think for some reason, when I'm talking to girls that they would like to be future funded, most of the time, a lot of the times they tell me like, well, I don't know if technology is for me. So like for some reason, and in our mindset, in our brains, they have put, you know, society have decided technology is not for women, mm-hmm. that it's too difficult for us, it's too narrow, it's too structured, it's too, and there is no space to, you know, to be creative there. There is no mm-hmm. space to have emotions there. There is, and it has nothing to do with that. Mm-hmm. But all this inside our mindset for all this year. So we said, no, that's not for me. Mm-hmm. So we are putting, you know, this like small circle around us, and we are here inside this small circle, and we are afraid to, you know, go outside, but and we do it ourselves. Mm-hmm. But because all this socialization and education we've been receiving for all these years, so, and then when you find maybe a girl that she is like, no, I've been trying coding and I would love to do it, then they say, oh, okay, but then they could find the economic barrier. But money is just, we were saying before, no, it's just a way, it's, mm-hmm. a tool. So we have created this crowdfunding platform to solve this money issue, let's say. Mm-hmm. But that's not the main goal or objective of FutureFunded. Mm-hmm. Future, what we want is to create this ecosystem, this comfort area where you can find advice and other people, other women like you, other men that wants to support you, and you feel like empowered to do it on your own. It's mm-hmm. like to create this, like, you know, place that where you become like stronger to do that. Mm-hmm. And for this, yes, you need money, you need role models, you need advice. So we are creating all that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So with FutureFunded, you're going to help women start in tech. And I think most of the funded women will use the funds then to start into a coding school, maybe a 3-month coding school. And do you think this gives them already the tools, the background, the knowledge to start a career in coding? Or do you think it still needs more... more knowledge or to study maybe computer science? So is this 3-month coding course already mm-hmm. enough to start, do you think?
I think that today, because everything is changing so fast, we need to train the capacity of learning fast. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe there will be people that is not agree on that, but I believe that you need to be capable to learn, you know, things on the go and mm-hmm. and practice them. And once you are practicing those things, you are gonna learn those things like more in depth and more in real. So mm-hmm. I mean, I don't have anything against like being 4 years in a university, but if you can have like a 3 months or 5 months like super intensive course and then straight after go to a job, to the job market, and put in practice all these skills, mm-hmm. in 1 year working, I think you're gonna learn like what you can learn like 10 years in university. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's at least my experience. I've been learning so much like working mm-hmm. and putting things like in practices, facing like real challenges. And but I think you need this base to mm-hmm. start, right? You cannot go like, hey, I'm gonna code. Well, you need a base, and then from that base go to real world and learn, and then mm-hmm. keep learning like during all your life, and add like content, academic content, and then go to company, and then add another layer of academic content, and then put in practice, and then start a project, and you know, do your kind of like recipe, where you can learn from all these inputs, mm-hmm. not just from 4 years in university. You yeah. can learn from, you know, so many things.
Okay, so we learned that money is not the main problem for women starting in tech, and what other things you think would have to change in society or in the corporate world nowadays in order to drag more women in and to get them excited for tech?
Well, I think, for instance, this tech world, and that is mostly composed by men, they should be aware that women are half of the society in the world, mm-hmm. and that also that we're going to a very technological world, and we need one to have these women working in this field, so we don't want women to be outside of the workforce. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing. And then we need men and women designing and creating for our society, not to have just one perspective. We want to have, and we don't want to have either the gender perspective. We want to have as many perspectives as we want, mm-hmm. as the world is like very diverse, mm-hmm. again, right? So when your team is diverse, and not just in gender but also in culture, and you are designing for a world that is diverse, I mean, you're going to be much more efficient in the way you create, you imagine, you design, and for your users outside, because your user is going to be also diverse. Mm-hmm. So it's just also a reason of like being efficiency. Mm-hmm. Efficient.
Okay. And what do you think about quotas, like having a specific percentage of women in a company board, or let's say as a speaker lineup at a conference? Do you think like these quotas and able to force a certain amount of women is something that is really helping, or is it counterintuitive? Or
Yeah, there are many opinions on that, and you will listen like opinions like pro and against coming from women also. Mm-hmm. But I'm super in favor of that, because in ideal world, when you know everything is equal, mm-hmm. perfect. But in our world, where it is not perfect and not idealistic, and we have an imbalance that is incredible among many collectives and many things, we need, if we want to achieve an equal world, we need to put this kind of quotas in mm-hmm. conferences, in companies, in management positions, in all that. We have to do that if we want to reach that. I was reading the other day, like last week, in World Economic Forum, they say if we continue doing the same gender politics and all that that we've been doing until now, it's going to take us 270 years to end with the gender gap. Mm-hmm. So yes, we need to put all these quotas like starting now and for real. Mm-hmm. Like if you don't do it, you will have a penalization, mm-hmm. and then companies are forced to do it.
Okay.
And here there is another thing that there is all this like being a mother, mm-hmm. that you know it goes together in all that, because sometimes why we don't have all these women in this power position. Because they are going to be moms, but we don't have laws that, you know, that help you to be a mom and be a professional. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when if you go to a position and they say, okay, this lady, maybe she's going to want to have a baby while mm-hmm. she's out, I'm going to take the boy. You cannot do these things. Mm-hmm. And there is no laws that protect all that. And, you know, there's so many things that we need to do, and I'm super favored. Like, we have to put, like, laws and quotas and all that in yeah. order to have
okay.
an equal.
Speaking about laws, Iceland currently passed a new legislation about the topic of equal pay, and there it's basically now almost illegal for employers to pay women less than they pay men for the same amount of work. I think we would agree that it's fair and that it makes sense, right? But do you think this is practical and actually something that will be able to be facilitated in the real world from on day to day?
I think so. In Europe, you have laws for have a minimum salary for everyone, mm-hmm. whereas you can have a law that say men and women, they get paid the same.
Yeah.
End of the conversation.
Okay.
It's super simple for me. Mm-hmm.
So you think we're going to see this in other countries, hopefully, and it will be no problem to facilitate that in real life, in the day-to-day business?
I hope so. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't.
Yeah.
But I hope so.
Okay. Coming back to FutureFunded, so how does the process work for a woman who would like to receive funding and or raise funding through your platform? What are the steps there? And also, what are the perks that a woman basically then offers to companies and funders in return?
Okay, so the idea, so we said that, for example, I want to study coding, and I might not have the money to do it. Mm-hmm. Okay, we said it's not the main barrier, but you need this money to go to the course, right? And we also realized that maybe because you don't have this money, because you are unemployed or underemployed, mm-hmm. you are gonna, you know, continue in the same vicious circle. So we said, okay, money is not gonna be a problem for you anymore, so you can do, you know, this process. Mm-hmm. So you say, I want to learn how to code, and it costs 6,000 euros, so I'm going to create a crowdfunding campaign of myself. Mm-hmm. So you create a video of yourself, we accompany you during all this process, you create a social media strategic campaign with us, we create a pre-campaign together, that means, okay, which kind of companies I would like to work, which kind of rewards I can offer, and all that. So during a month, we create all that, which is your campaign. Mm-hmm. While doing that, you are developing your, you know, creative thinking, leadership, fundraising, and all that. And then during another month, we do a thing that we say pre-campaign. So we start reaching out like organizations that might like your they might buy your reward or your service, mm-hmm. or a company that they might, you know, hire you, mm-hmm. and all that. So we do all this process like in the back, let's say.
Okay.
And then the third month we launch the campaign, mm-hmm. and we fundraise. Mm-hmm. So the idea, I think, this thing that I'm going to explain now, I should explain before, but it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. The idea is like in a regular crowdfunding campaign, you offer rewards. And mm-hmm. here, the rewards is like your workforce, mm-hmm. so with your new skills. So if you are going to learn how to code, you're going to be able to code. So you mm-hmm. can offer a company that you will work for them for, you know, 2 months if they put $3,000 in your campaign. Mm-hmm. Or you are going to do a coding workshop for beginners in the school of your neighborhood, mm-hmm. or things like that, always using your new skills yeah. that you're going to take from the program. Mm-hmm.
And where do you see FutureFunded 3 years from now? And are you potentially open up to other target groups, or will it be always focused on mm-hmm. Women?
I like that you asked me that question, because now I have an answer. Mm-hmm. Because we did all this prediction that then, you know, things, you never know how they can go. But we said we want to start in Barcelona and in Spain, but mostly in Barcelona, because FutureFunded comes from another project we started a few years ago that was for unemployed youth in Barcelona. Mm-hmm. And so in Catalonia, but in Spain, we have a very high unemployment among youth. So for us, it's very important that we try to, you know, to fix that somehow here in Spain, Catalonia, Barcelona, whatever, which is our, you know, hometown now. Mm-hmm. And this is going to allow us to also streamline the process and the model, to understand very well how it works, what are the expectations and the motivations of the aspirants, but also from the contributors and companies and all that. Mm-hmm. And with this knowledge, then we want to go to another country in Europe, mm-hmm. which has a bigger market, but it's close to Spanish market, you know, there is not in be France or England. And then the idea in the third year is we go global. Mm-hmm. And maybe we start in America, I don't know if like North or Central, but the idea is this is an online platform, so it can be global. Mm-hmm. But we want to understand very well all the process, how it is for the aspirant and how it is for all these contributors. And we want to do it locally because it makes sense for us, because we are from here. So mm-hmm.
makes sense, yeah. Before we close off, I want to come back again to the female topic, the gender topic, and the question is when you're starting in a coding school as a woman, and all the other, or you're there with, let's say, 20 other guys and you're the only woman, it might feel a little bit intimidating maybe, or you might feel a little bit alone. So do you think that maybe female-only coding schools or female-only coding classes make sense? And do you think that this maybe would even make it easier for women mm-hmm. to learn?
Yes. And now I remember a project that is just for women to learn how to code, mm-hmm. and it's in Madrid, and it's called Ada Lab, and it's just women learning to code. And for that said, I think, because I was also reading about that when they did this experiment with boys and girls all together in the same class, like 11, 12 years old, and they have these tests, and then, you know, girls, they had a lower score mm-hmm. yeah, than boys, because they felt that they were competing and all that, and they feel like kind of intimidated. Mm. And then when they did like the same test, like all on their own, like all girls together, they felt like they were collaborating for something together. And then the same test, they had a higher score. Mm-hmm. So, and there are many studies and cases that say that for girls, at least at the very beginning of when they are younger, mm-hmm. It's more suitable, comfortable, or they are able to, you know, like learn better and more if they are not like mixed.
Okay.
Then when you are an adult, I don't know, well, it's different. I think it's also the way like every girl or every woman mm-hmm. is, right?
Yeah.
But it's true that when, you know, you are surrounded by, you know, your girlfriends or other women, you feel right away, like more secure than if you are like with boys around you. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you boys have this feeling. I'm asking you. I don't know. I've never.
Good question.
Yeah, I've never asked you to avoid that.
Yeah. I think I've never been in a similar situation, but I definitely agree that we need more women in tech, not only in tech, also in politics, for example. I think it would be a much better place in the world if we would have more women in politics. So I really appreciate what you're doing in starting with tech. And do you have any final remarks what you want to share with the audience before we finish up? Or?
No.
Okay. Then thank you very much for your attention, and please go to futurefunded.co now and make sure to back the first campaign that is now live. Bye.